We're going to begin. I'd like to welcome everyone. The Center for Latin American Studies, which has organized this event, is particularly pleased that we have with us Tom Laqueur, who is a professor of history here at UC Berkeley, who's a cultural historian, whose work has focused in a wide range of areas, including popular religion and literacy and the history of the body, alive and dead, and on the history of death and memory. He will be talking today on the Day of the Dead, which is today the Day of the Dead, and he will give a presentation, and then we very much look forward to questions and a conversation after that presentation. He has won numerous awards as a historian and as a cultural historian, but he has said that what he is most proud of is the Mellon Distinguished Humanist Award, in part because he used the proceeds of that for seed money for programs on religion, human rights, and science studies here at Berkeley. In all three areas, these are now continuing programs, which his own award really began. So with that, I'm really pleased that Tom is here.
Thank you very much. Well, look, thank you very much. Let me just begin by correcting Harley. Today is not exactly the Day of the Dead. Today is, in the Christian calendar, is All Saints. And All Saints follows All Souls, which was last night, and Hallowed Eve, which is the night either between the two days. So, in one way, the Day of the Dead, as in the Mexican Day of the Dead, follows from a medieval Christian festival, which I'm going to tell you about in a moment. On the other hand, it also it's also as a specific Day of the Dead is relatively recent as an all Mexican event. It became a national holiday in the 1960s, and even earlier it was, when it was practiced at all, it was actually fairly localized in the center and the south of Mexico, in the west and the north it wasn't practiced. On the other hand, it was also part of grew out of Aztec and even earlier rituals, as it did in Europe. So in some sense, the Day of the Dead is sort of syncretic in Mexico and everywhere else between a Christian holiday, which began to happen around the 8th or 9th century, and became more formalized. The doctrines of purgatory and so forth became more formalized in the 12th and 13th century, and we can talk about this a little bit. But so it takes this tradition and marries it on to the other one. So for those of you who are not Christian, for learning in these matters, let me just say a little bit what the Day of the Dead, of what All Souls and All Saints is, I guess. And it's then celebrated in different, or it's observed in different ways in different Christian cultures. So All Souls was the one day in the medieval church in which the names of all the dead were read out loud, the dead of a parish. And I mean, all the people's names, and not just those who paid for special attention and for masses or prayers for souls. So you must, I'm sure you know this, that in the medieval church, probably the major form of charity was to give money to have priests say prayers or masses on for the benefit of your soul. So the idea is that soul, the person is gone, and yet it's still in some sort of, it's still in play, and that by invoking the saints, the souls can be helped. And this becomes more and more elaborate as the doctrine of purgatory is elaborated in the 12th and 13th century. Then, the next day is All Saints, which is a celebration of all the saints. And then, in some sense, by combining them, you invoke, or ritually invoke, the names of all the saints in the benefit of all the souls. Now, you wouldn't have visited a cemetery in the Middle Ages because the place of the burial have were around churches, And one of the great shifts in the coming of Christianity from paganism was the move of the dead from outside of cities, which is what it was in the whole classical world. It's still the case in the Muslim world. I mean, basically, Abrahamic religions buried outside. Basically, pagan religions buried outside, and the Christians brought them inside. So essentially, the big move in Christianity was to bring the bones of saints and the bones of ordinary people together in a church, in a village. So if you were to ask me, what's the biggest thing that happens in the move of paganism to Christianity, it's that the church or priesthood comes to take control of the dead versus families. Okay, so then this happens in different places at different times. In parts of France, it happens in the 4th and 5th century. In parts of northern Germany and Norway, and doesn't happen until the 9th and 10th century. But basically, by the 10th century, everyone's buried around in a churchyard, and every church has a relic, so some object of a saint. So in that sense, you didn't go visit the dead, you saw them every day. And so these cemeteries that they are now in Mexico, and as they are in the Latin countries, in fact, pretty much everywhere, or outside the city. So visiting cemeteries is basically a post-18th century development, because there just weren't a lot of cemeteries before. In many Catholic countries, they tend to be more outside than in Protestant countries. But by and large, the great cemeteries you think of in Latin America or anywhere are basically all 19th century, like Recoletas, 19th century, and so forth. So in some sense, visiting the dead, as you do it also on the Day of the Dead or All Saints, is new, because these different places, you didn't have to visit them, you just hung around them. So that's a new development. Okay, so then the Mexican case, and I'll take you a few others, the Mexican case goes back in its current form with these altars and these other branches, pretty much, as far as I can tell from Claudio, I'm no expert on this, but to the late 19th century, and really is elaborated in the 20th century. And becomes really elaborated, or most elaborated perhaps, in diaspora communities, and then makes its way back. And in places in Mexico where it never existed before, we were just talking about the fact that on the Pacific Coast they didn't have it. I mean, you visited cemeteries, but you didn't do all this elaborate kind of stuff. Okay, so in some sense, this is just one more of these remarkably creative things that people do, and they're always tied in some sense with commerce and with other political and social developments, as are what we do with the dead period since the beginning. So the Mexican case is not unusual, it's just a particular story of how the dead are connected to diasporas and to commerce and to a sense of national identity, as it became in the 1960s when it became a national holiday, where it's connected with educational other reforms. Okay, so it's based then on, or connected to, an Aztec holiday. The Aztec holiday was in August. And even before the Aztec, there are holidays that deal with remembering the souls of the dead. And incidentally, of course, Judaism remembers the souls of the dead and reads their names. It does it four times a year, unlike the Christians, who do just once. So Itzkor is a name in which is the Passover, it's the Yom Kippur, and two other occasions in which the names of the dead are invoked, and acts of charity are done in their name. In the English case, All Souls and All Saints corresponds to a Celtic holiday of the dead at roughly the same days. And the Celtic holidays, or the Celts, these Nordic people, were around not just in Ireland, but also in France, and sort of part of a Nordic cultural zone. So basically, the Christian Day of the Dead in Europe is sort of syncretic with earlier, very much earlier, pagan days of the dead, or All Saints. So what we see here, the holiday we're talking about now, is a Christian holiday, which is syncretic or built upon pagan holidays, or pagan festivals of the dead, and which we can find examples of pretty much everywhere. So almost every culture. Okay, so, and we could go through many of these. So why do we do this? Why does every culture do it, and why do we then, and every culture reappropriates it and names it in different ways? So now we have all these elaborate skeletons and special food and drinks and so forth, but our ancestors didn't do that, or they did it in different ways, right? So the question I want to pose to you now is, why is this the case? Well, in its deepest sense, It's the case because we, and pretty much everyone, has believed that whatever we actually think or ever claim to think about the afterlife or souls or whatever, believe the dead are somewhere. And that it takes a certain amount of time for them to actually be gone. So I'm not sure how many of us believe or think about our great-great-great-grandparents, though if you visit their graves, you do actually believe that they're present. But all of us believe that we no longer have our parents or our grandparents, that they're somewhere. And I think that you would say that they're somewhere, even if I gave you a checklist, do you believe in the immortality of the soul? Do you believe in a bunch of things? You would say, yeah, maybe, and I'm not sure, never thought about it, or something. But you do actually, okay. So I think that's kind of a given everywhere. So we care then for two things. We care for the bodies of the dead, and we care what we call the souls of the dead, but we even care about them when we don't think of them as souls. So we read the names of the dead at the Vietnam Memorial, even though I don't think anyone you ask there would say, I'm praying for the souls of the dead, or I'm doing this ritual because I believe there's actually a person there or a soul there or anything else you'd subscribe to. So we do a long history of caring for the dead. As far as we know, no culture that bears any resemblance to humans have not cared for their dead. So paleoarchaeologists find bones in caves, and they distinguish between bones that have been gnawed upon by animals and bones that have been ritualistically flayed with stone tools, and they can tell the difference between these. So all the evidence suggests that as far back as you can go, that's the case. When we look at the very earliest settled human communities in Asia Minor, in Kataluyuk, which is about 6,000 years BCE, one finds ritualistic burials underneath the houses. So it's something that happens pretty much everywhere in pretty much the same ways. So they cremate, they burn, they put the bodies in the air, slightly later, comes later, the Zoroastrian tradition, and very rarely we put it in water. So basically, we deal with the dead bodies by returning to the elements in one ritualistic way or the other. And everyone has a reason for why they do it that way rather than some other way. But they don't really explain very much. So the Greeks supposedly cremated. Archaeologists have now found out that they bury lots of times. And famously, Antigone, the issue is burial. And so, again, you can't prove how many times you went up this, is that, or the other. But as far as you can tell from the archaeological evidence, it does this, it does that. And everyone has a post-hoc reason for why it happened, including us. Like, we cremate because it saves space. We used to think it was ecological. Now it turns out not to be ecological. But they're all post-hoc reasons. And there are these great changes, and we don't understand why the changes happened. So in the ancient world, by and large, they cremated. Then by and large, they started burial. It used to be thought the Christians did it. This was the Christianity. Turns out it's not the case. So everyone does it ritualistically. Everyone has a post-hoc reason for doing it. But those post-hoc reasons, to me, don't explain it. What really matters is the ritualistic care of the dead and the belief in the presence of the dead. Now, that belief and the actions on that belief are irrelevant even when you explicitly say you don't believe in it. So, in other words, not just sort of don't believe in it, you actually have as part of your ideological framework that you don't believe in it. And the example that brought this to mind for me is visiting Marx's tomb in Highgate Cemetery. So there's a guy, Marx wrote in addition to being a materialist and not believing in God and so forth and so on, wrote his dissertation. He was a PhD in philosophy. And he wrote his PhD on Epicurus. And Epicurus is the most is the locus classicus for the classical view that bodies are just made up of material atoms, and that once the motion of these atoms stop when you're dead, you're dead. And they'll never be resurrected. I mean, there were some early Christians who thought, well, you don't have maybe the soul is a Platonic imagination, but God will resurrect all the atoms of your body and you'll be just the way you were before. No, says Epicurus, once you're gone, you're gone. You're really gone. You're just dirt like you were, full stop, end of story. So Marx's followers in 1955 dig him up from a grave down the hill and put him on top of the hill in a very expensive piece of real estate, a really expensive piece of real estate, a piece of real estate that must cost 20 times a worker's salary for a year. Put him up in this place, build an even more expensive and very hideous statue, and then the comrades from all over the world are buried around him. So they have the Iraqi Communist Party, the Jamaican Communist Party, and the South African Communist Party. They're all around Karl Marx. So if you visit Karl Marx's tomb in London now, it'll look to you like the Sufi shrine. And just 2 years ago, the greatest Marxist historian of the 20th century, a man named Eric Hobsbawm, bought a box tomb as big as two of these tables put together within 20 feet of Karl Marx. It must have cost his family 50,000, 80,000 pounds. I mean, just, you know, fabulously expensive real estate. There he is in a big box tomb, but he's not even in the box tomb. His ashes are in the box tomb. So then you ask yourself, why would this materialist historian want to have his ashes next to a body which no longer exists? And you say, ah, and you'd scratch your head and you probably wouldn't come up with a very good answer. But then you say, okay, it's memory, and you want to have a community of memory, that's cool. And then you say, well, do you actually need to spend X tens of thousands of pounds to have memory, to have ashes, which are just like every other ashes and no different from the fertilizer you buy? Couldn't you just put up a name plaque? No, you need to have the body. Likewise, at the 9/11 shrine, likewise in the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier, likewise in the cemeteries where they're naming the dead of the Colma air crash, you know, everywhere, you want these bodies there. So on the head of the bodies, we really do want bodies, whatever we believe about. And somehow we believe the dead are in those, near those, related to those bodies, despite actually knowing they're not, point one, and having, in some cases, the Marxist roots, having a huge philosophical vocabulary which explains to you why they're not there. Okay, that's point one. The second part of this is then, and in the Mexican day of the day, as you know, it's very material. Skeletons and skulls are there. So it's not about souls, it's about bodies, which are somehow meant to be sort of happily cavorting around the graves of the dead in some fantastic world, which they're clearly not. But we represent it, and it's sort of comforting to represent it, and we get into it. So the Mexican version is actually very more material than most versions, and it's probably nearer the medieval version of how you regard the dead as really there. But let's take the material part. So the dead are really sort of there in their bodies. Well, where else are the dead there? On Halloween. Bodies on the one hand, skulls, and what else? What's the other Halloween symbols? Ghosts. Yeah, ghosts. So the two, so they're ghosts. And as we, the technical called the revenants, so those who have returned. And there are two sorts of revenants. Almost every revenant is unhappy. So the Casper the Friendly Ghost is called the Friendly Ghost because he's so rare. Those of you who know this cartoon, ghosts are by and large not friendly. Almost completely not friendly. So the question of ghosts has to do with the porosity of the world between the living and the dead. In general, in monotheistic religions, the land of the dead and the land of the living is relatively impermeable. So the entire Old Testament, there's one ghost, the ghost of Samuel. And it's big trouble when the ghost of Samuel appears, because he prophesies the end of Saul. And it's thought, and necromancy, at least the rabbinic tradition, is thought to be a very bad thing. The church fathers sort of believed in ghosts in principle, but tried to suppress popular beliefs in ghosts because they quite rightly associated popular beliefs in ghosts with paganism and with a world in which no one was really in charge of the dead. So if you think of the Greek stories, you know, you think of the Iliad or you think of the Aeneid, a Roman story, improperly buried people end up as shades all over the place and end up plaguing the living. The church fathers who created Christianity opposed this because it was against the power of God. God kept the dead with them. So, so that's the basic structure. So the population of ghosts basically goes up and down. Now let's just look at the Christian West, having to do with how much authority you want to believe God has over them, and or how much God allows the dead to come back. So with the rise of purgatory in the 12th and 13th century, there was the notion that the dead are inhabit this place, which gets increasingly elaborated in people's people's imaginations. Here you have all these souls in purgatory who are not doing so well. And it is in the interest of the priestly class to speak, well, of course they can come back. You didn't give enough charity, and if you don't give enough charity, they're going to be back. So the number of ghost stories increases dramatically with the rise of purgatory. Then you expect it to go down with the Protestant Reformation in Protestant countries, because the Protestants don't believe in purgatory and aren't so keen on ghosts in principle and think that ghosts are just a Catholic plot. I mean, Chaucer's line that says, you know, that before the friars came, there were no ghosts and fairies in England. So in other words, it's brought with them by priests for their own interest. But in fact, the ghosts don't go away. And if you sort of, I sort of did a survey of ghost stories. There's many ghost stories and stories of ghosts in Protestant parts of Europe as in Catholic parts of Europe, because once they're in, they're in. And giving up on ghosts is a big deal. So they're ghosts. I'm not putting this in the general category. There are actually two categories of ghosts, or the revenant, I should say. They're the fleshly revenant, and they're the ethereal revenant. So the fleshly revenant, there are a lot of those, they tend to be in polytheistic religions. A lot of the fleshly ghosts in Chinese popular religion, the walking dead, are quite common. Vampires. So we have archaeological evidence of people burying people. This recent find in Poland, in which people are buried with bricks in their mouths, thought to be vampires. Norse mythology is full of ghosts, of fleshly ghosts. Some of them, draugrs, wander far afield. Others are more local, cause disturbances in the weather. So this, and now we have zombies, which is a relatively new version of the fleshly sort of revenant, which represents something else. So they're those kind of guys. Then there are all these ethereal ghosts, like we get for Halloween and for these days, which also come in different versions. Because if you're really ethereal, you're not able to pinch people or go boo, or do all the things that ghosts do. So there's obviously a thin line between this, the fleshly and the not fleshly. I mean, this is a taxonomic distinction and one that doesn't exist in nature. But all those ghosts are also ones who you think about come back because they're unhappy about something. So Hamlet's father comes back to say, look, I was murdered. Or people come back to say, I was cheated on something, or a debt wasn't paid, or I wasn't properly buried. Or you married my wife too soon after I died. Or, in other words, it's some version of stories in which the dead claim that the living have somehow done them ill. And the reason we have them back, the deep part of this is that putting someone to rest is actually a gigantic cultural product. I mean, it's a huge chasm between the living and the dead. If any of you have seen a dead person or been involved with, it's a big deal. It's big. It doesn't get any bigger as a chasm. On the other hand, it's very hard to say, well, okay, now they're gone. This is it. Just, we don't. So we have a funeral, which helps usher them out of the world. And we're probably a little slow in cleaning out their possessions. We probably don't get them all away at once. We probably wait a month or two. People don't remarry instantly. I mean, in other words, we actually act. And partly it's because we sorrow, but also I think it's partly because it takes a while to actually have someone be dead. In fact, it takes something a very long while. And meanwhile, the dead are still part of our world and occasionally will come back. So the question then is, okay, so ghosts and the returning dead have always been around. They could take fleshly and not fleshly versions. They've always been a problem. So it's not as if in antiquity or in other cultures someone says, oh, they're as real as a person walking around. They're never quite as real because they're dead. And so and to be dead is, after all, think about it, not just to not be living anymore as a biological being, but also means that the land has been given away, the tools have been given away. So that in one hand, we've acted as if they're gone. On the other hand, it's difficult to do. So we always believe that somehow they're coming back, and they're always problematic. So they were problematic in Greek antiquity, and they're problematic in the Chinese tradition, and they're problematic in the early Christian tradition, and they were problematic when the Protestant theologians worried about them. And everyone has a reason why they're problematic and why you want them to stay. So Protestant theologians, who had a very good reason to not believe in ghosts, and who thought this was all, as I said, part of the kind of Catholic superstition, said, well, look, if we get rid of ghosts, we also get rid of spirits, and we get rid of angels, and we get rid of the whole plenum of beings, and we end up with Thomas Hobbes. I mean, we end up with the materialist world. I mean, that was explicitly the argument. I mean, Baxter, was probably this famous Puritan theologian, makes this argument. He says, look, we cannot give up on the possibility of ghosts, because it would be to give up essentially the whole world of that makes our world what it is. So, ghosts are always strange. And they're always being reinvented. And if I were to say, what's the modern history of ghosts? And people who ought to know better, Jeremy Bentham, we may have heard of, the great utilitarian philosopher, Mr. Reasonable, the calculator of pain and pleasure, said tells you all his life he's waited not believe in ghosts and take them to be nonsense, and yet he's never been able to expunge them from his consciousness. So it's very hard to get rid of somehow the dead living in us. So what's happened, I think, since the 18th century, and even more powerfully more recently, is that the ghosts, the revenant, and the dead more generally have moved inward. And we recognize them in somehow as inward, although it's not clear that we recognize them as being, they're not figments. What they are is as much is a problem for us as it is for others. And why is that the case? And I want to conclude that that's the case for a reason that I think that Freud gets right. So I'm going to end with Freud. Reason, he says, is very little help on this matter. After tens of thousands of years, there's been very little progress. In hardly any other sphere, he says, has our thinking and feeling changed so little since primitive times. Oh, the old times have been so well preserved under a thin veneer as in our relationship to death.
Yep. I wanted to ask, you made a couple comments about the Day of the Dead in Mexico being sort of really coming into being as we know it now, mostly in the 20th century.
Right.
So would you say that it's a tradition as we see it now that has internalized this idea of death coming inward, or is it more of a remnant of this sort of outward idea?
It's a very good question. I mean, many of you will know more about this than I do. It is always said, as you know, that I mean the Mexican case. You go and you feast with the dead, which of course is not just Mexican. The Romans famously feast with the dead, and you go, Chinese feast with the dead. I mean, so it's not just Mexican. Everyone feasts with the dead. And how we understand it? If you ask people in the churchyard, and we're happy, are we really feasting with the dead? Are the dead around? I'm not sure what you would, what kind of answer you'd get. I mean, and so I'm not sure what kind of answer you'd get. So that's why I'm a little, when I want to say inward now, I say this kind of reluctantly when I'm inward. I mean, most of us would say, if we heard rapping at the table, we would be unlikely to believe it to be ghosts. I would find almost any hypothesis better than the noise you hear to be actually the revenant. So in that sense, we believe them not. I do not believe in ghosts. But do I believe that my parents are somewhere and that my mother is sort of still in the audience? The answer is yes. And do I really believe this? It depends on what the purchaser really is. You see what I mean? In other words, and I think the powerful thing about the dead as a cultural force is that the really is so, how to put it, elastic as a concept. Which doesn't mean to say that I don't believe that my friends who study Mexico and who go to churches in Mexico where purgatory is still a big deal, unlike in much of European Catholicism, that people don't really believe if they light a candle or if they buy a medal that it actually helps the souls of purgatory. I'm sure they really believe it. But if you interviewed them, what is it you really believe? It'd be hard. You'd have a hard time getting the purchase of that. I don't think many people still imagine the sulphurous lakes of Hieronymus Bosch paintings. You see what I'm saying? So I really is a difficult concept for me, and it's one that is often a problem because I understand that really, quote, Mexican peasant or some person somewhere who still thinks this is actually living in this tradition has a different view than I of it. So they think really, and I think not really. But all of us have this, you know. So you can have really R sub one, R sub two. You see what I mean?
Yeah.
But what struck me in my research is how invariant these things are under different systems of belief. That's why I gave you the Marx example. Now I can give you many more examples like that. In other words, people act as if something's the case when they explicitly and implicitly, they explicitly don't believe it. So that, and I think, yeah, so that.
You mentioned that ghosts are always nasty.
Not always. There are a few friendly ghosts, but rare.
I'm wondering if that's our own guilt about something or another, and we feel that now I kind of remedy the situation because you're not here to say I'm sorry or do something good. So they're gone, and damn, they're gone. And this guilt that I have about that person is coming back to haunt me.
That would be Freud's view. That would be the view of many 20th century people think about ghosts. Mm-hmm. It is actually guilt. Much of what you say about ghosts, people have written, they say, you know, 80% of what I say about ghosts is complete nonsense and superstition and crazy. But I do feel guilty to my mother-in-law or to someone. And so there is this projection of guilt. And so in the old days, people would say it's not a projection of guilt. They would say, we actually did screw the guy. You know, we actually didn't do. And we all have wronged the dead or wronged our fellow beings. And so it's not very hard to say, well, yeah, I did. We didn't pay that debt, and it would have made his life happier if he'd paid it. And in the Hamlet case, where the famous conundrum in Shakespeare's studies is the ghost real? Is this Protestant England? You're not supposed to believe in ghosts. Maybe Shakespeare was a crypto-Catholic. I mean, he probably was a crypto-Catholic. But the quote reality of the ghost in Shakespeare is a major problem in doing this, and it's a problem how you stage it. The armor is real, but the ghost is not real. You see, in other words, it's a real issue, but it's totally clear that there's an enormous amount of guilt. I mean, it's something really is rotten in Denmark. You see what I mean? So, again, this comes up with this issue of back in the 16th century, the question of the realness of it is a problem, but the guilt part is not a problem. You see what I mean?
Uh-huh.
And that's true when Achilles didn't bury Patroclus in the Iliad. You see what I mean? It keeps coming up, even though there's a different theory pertains of the dead in the Iliad than it pertains in 16th century England, than it pertains in 21st century Berkeley. We would all have very different, we're post-psychoanalysts, they had heard of psychoanalysis, the Greeks were pre-Christian, and yet the guilt that you're not doing something right by the dead is still there, right? So I would, being a secular guy, would say it's always guilt. But that's not one of the.
So I would like to pick up on what you said with Ms. Mertz there regarding the guilt. I'm originally from Madagascar, and that's what brought me here in terms of. I was curious about how the dead are taken care of, or the way you presented it in your topic, because we have this very unusual practice of. Reburial of the dead.
It's not so unusual. The Greek church does it.
Yeah, our ancestors, you know, Indonesia, Malaysia, so that part.
No, Greece.
Something that intrigued me with the guilt aspect is that, you know, for my specific culture, it comes in the form of dreams, which might be, you know, kind of the subconscious.
Absolutely, yeah, interesting.
Especially, I think, something that comes up and is about people not being properly buried.
Yeah.
because there are some very elaborate rituals. So what struck me about the presentation here is like you said, you know, like it's all across cultures, there is always this, what you call the invariant aspect of how one deals with the dead, present or not, the food, the eating, etc. Which reminds me of a, I'm going to share this joke. So the story takes place in China where Americans are visiting with their
18th century. So being properly buried, whatever that means, is a big story. And that's, again, it is actually relevant. So for, as you know, Western Christian churches bury east to west. So come the Quakers, who want to reject this particular liturgical system and believe in the religion of the spirit, bury north to south. And so do radical Puritans. And when they came to North America, some of these radical Puritans explicitly buried in all directions. But then when you go to New England Church, you'll find somehow it ends up being east to west again, because of the power of this tradition. So the Greeks do secondary burial. The Western Church doesn't do secondary burial, but digs up the bones after a while because they don't make any difference anymore and throws them in the charnel house.
What does secondary burial mean?
Secondary means, we were speaking of the after some amount of time, I don't know, how long is it in Madagascar?
5 years.
5 years.
Or if they're buried somewhere else,
they're brought back. Five years is the Greek. There must be some story about 5 years. Like 3 days is a common burial story. And you find that became the rule in the 19th century, but when you go back to early modern records, medieval records, more you can tell, it's a 3 day period. No, look, the dead getting in the right place is particularly true in China. When I was doing research for this, I went to a conference. It's a very fancy conference. I mean, all sorts of, fancy. Big, in other words, people from major universities and regular academic conference. And there was a talk by an anthropologist from South China about what's called the walking dead. And the walking dead are the dead in China who got buried in the wrong place, like if there was a battle and the dead didn't get put in the geomantically correct place. You know, the Chinese, there's a big culture of getting the body in the right alignment as well as in the right place. So the dead are walking, it is said. And we all did some sort of anthropological take, of course it's important and the imaginable, we anthropologize it. And there was a guy there who died recently, who was a New York Times a bit, named Anthony Liu, who was a very important Chinese scholar, but also had a PhD in classics. So he knew these two traditions. He was very westernized. He was a brilliant classical musician as well. So this is a westernized guy who was the son of an important Kuomintang general, who was also Western educated in engineering. And he says, my father told me that he and his troops were occupying a particular village during the Chinese Civil War. And the villagers came to him and said, look, large numbers of the dead are going to be walking through here tonight. And if you stop them, it's all over for us. And they're going to wreak revenge on our village. So please let them go by. And it was well known that the opposite, the Chinese communist side often tried to sneak troops through, claiming they were the dead walking. So the general said, I'm going to fall for this one, says General Liu. And they said, no, please, just don't be in the road. You can watch. And if you think that they're troops, you can act accordingly. But I'm telling you, these are the real walking dead, say the villagers. So his dad says, Tony, the guy knew, is outside the village on some place where they can watch. And sure enough, at a particular hour, hundreds of these dead come through, and they all have lanterns on their head, and they're all wearing awkwardly, and they're being walked by someone who gets them to the right place. And they lean against the local pub alehouse for their driver, their shepherd, to rest. And then they moved on, and the village was safe, and General Liu's troops returned. End of story. So we all looked at him like, huh? So actually couldn't believe the story. So when I was writing, I took these notes maybe 20 years ago. So I wrote him telling you the story, and it was near the end of his life. Is this true? And did you tell this straight as I'm imagining you tell it? And he corrected, I can't, maybe a different detail. It wasn't a village, it was by a river. I can't remember the, I mean, I have a footnote where I explain his little corrections in my story, but he sticks by the story. So I kind of give up on the idea of what is the notion, what's the real here? So it's a bit like when you do medieval religious history, you can't actually ask, did St. Francis really get the stigmata? I mean, it's kind of, you know what I mean? I mean, there's nothing in it to say, did he really get the stigmata? People thought, or that these fasting girls really never ate, or that, you know what I mean? And so I give it up on the notion of the real. But what's interesting, when you say you have to, if you're in the wrong place, you got to move back to the right place. And people still today move bodies around. El Al makes a lot of money sending Jews from America back to Israel. Bodies are being shipped all over the place to get them back in the right place. Look at the 9/11 thing. People collecting the bone fragments from New Jersey dumps and trying to be sure they're human and move them to the memorial. So it's all over the place. Rich, famous people, not famous people. Go figure. There's something, we do something very important with doing it. That's why I call it the work of the dead. But if you actually tried to, I don't think, I get criticized some of the things, well, why do we think we do it? What's really the reason? I have no clue what really is the reason. I'm just telling you, humans have always done some version of this. And really would be what, if I made up an evolutionary reason, would that make you feel happier? You know what I mean? In other words, there isn't a really in the sense of really that there's a burial gene. Or, you know, in other words, there's no really. It's just the case that one way or the other, the living have needed the dead more than the dead have needed the living. You know? But I'm fascinated that the Madagascars do it and the Greeks do it, and we can find other cultures that rebury too. And some we don't. Jews, of course, it's horrible to rebury. And Islam is horrible to rebury. So it's a very...
Can you say something more about All Souls Day and charity, or was the charity or the membership dues or whatever people were paying to their church, to their local churches, is that burdensome? I mean, because the implication is that All Souls Day is sort of like your one free day to make sure you've got a mass set for your dead.
You
might not be able to afford it. So
well, you could do it. No.
Somebody be nervous that they're dead or not.
Oh, yeah. Well, look, I mean, I don't know the exact figures for most places, but a third in England, a third of the land of England was owned by religious institutions whose main purpose was to pray for the dead. So, one of the things that financed the wars of Henry VIII was confiscating the lands of the chantries. And chantries were special. Chantry priests were people paid to say prayers for the dead. And monasteries were places where the names of the dead were recorded. So these so-called books of the dead, Liber Memorialis, memory books, were created. If you paid money, you got your name in this book. And it would be either read on your death day or read every day. It also creates fictive communities of the dead. So donors to a monastery would all have their names in the book, even if they weren't buried there. So it produces a kind of community. We pray for all these dead who are all part of our family.
So is there any indication that was somehow burdensome on the population?
No, you didn't pay. But no, it's like if you could afford it, you spent money on this particular kind of charity, which, of course, it's spent on other monks spent it. Be helping the poor as well, but I wouldn't say it's exactly burdensome. I mean, but it was an important way. It was the way the church supported itself. That's why I said the most important move in the creation of paganism to Christianity was the church's assumption of responsibility for the dead. So in Western antiquity, I should say, and in much of Mesopotamia, families took care of themselves. In other words, if you were a halfway prosperous, an artisanal family above in Rome would have bought a place, either in the catacombs, or if you could afford it out of the Appia or somewhere else, and it was your responsibility. And you went and ate with the dead, like in the days of the dead, and you would have put up a tomb more or less great. It was your responsibility. What the medieval church did is said that all those who are not amongst us are excluded. So there are all sorts of stories about God taking sinners and non-Christians, and other people, they just cast them out of churchyards. Out they go, quite spectacularly. nuns who had been horrible just get thrown out. God would just throw them out. And the people who ran are in. So you, so it's not exactly burden. It's what supports the church. In other words, that's, I guess you call it burdensome. There was a tithe supported it too. But that was how the church, that's how the church lived. I mean, what they did was to care for your souls and the souls of the dead. That's what, right? So in other words, it's not a, it's sort of add-on. It's the central feature. And All Souls was the one day in which everyone's name was read. It's in some day, and that's true in Jewish communities, you, on these 4 days, you people, you read, it's called, you read people's names. But again, if you push someone to actually say in the Jewish tradition, does the acts of charity you do for everybody really help the souls of the dead? Rabbis would have a hard time arguing for this.
What I'm thinking is something from High Holiday Services, the right. Jewish tradition, which is that there a lot of synagogues will have a free section where, or a free audience area where they expect the majority of attendees to have bought a ticket to participate in High Holiday Services,
right.
But they will often also have a charity section area.
Right.
Where
right,
people
right,
who didn't buy
right,
a ticket can
right.
Still
well, of course, that's in modern Judaism. That would have been true in the little churches of the shtetls of Europe. I mean, that, look, a lot of this stuff is, what's really interesting to me is how we keep reinventing these rituals. We're just always reinventing some ritual. You know, and now we reinvent them with ashes. You know, I mean, maybe someday we won't care for the dead. I mean, I didn't actually do research in this, but you know, you'd meet people at a cocktail party and say, what are you working on? And I'd say this. And they'd say, oh, really? Well, you see this tattoo? These are my grandmother's ashes, which I made into ink. And I tattooed. Or there's a guy at West Virginia. I grew up in West Virginia and rural Virginia. And the kid I grew up next to, and then also had a summer, his parents had a summer place next to our summer place. He used to go hunting with a guy. Very devout Methodist, back in a cabin way back in the mountains with no water. It was pretty, very primitive. And they'd go hunt together. And this guy who died made black powder himself, you know, for black powder musket loading. So he dies, and he is, he's a Methodist, a devout member of the church. He has an open casket funeral, all the religious stuff. He's then cremated. And various people get his ashes, including his hunting buddies. So his hunting buddies take his ashes to Wolf Creek, which is where this place is. And some of the ashes they put on the salt, on a deer salt lake. So the deer will ingest the ashes, and then the next year they will shoot the deer. So that's right out of anthropology land, right? Some of the ashes are put in a place where they sort of all pee together. And that has this thing, Freud and Civilization Discontent has this great story about the creation, fictive story about the creation of the band of brothers around common urination. Put back at that. And the third part of his ashes, they put into a you know, shotgun shell, you know, the paper, a shotgun shell with his black powder, and shot a bunch of these shells into the heavens. Now, famously, Hunter Thompson had his ashes shot into the heavens in a, you know, small rocket. Did the guys read Hunter Thompson? Of course they hadn't read Hunter Thompson. So what's fascinating to me is here these guys in rural Virginia end up making up this quite loony, I mean, story. This would be very, any anthro student who finds this among people in Madagascar or in wherever would say, oh, this is worth my field trip to these exotic peoples. Yeah. And there you are. And so do I have an explanation in terms of the folk belief for these people? I have no explanation. And I can give you 20 more stories about weird things people have done with their ashes. Or fake, when you get the wrong ashes into place. The chair of my department, his wife's father, they gave him the wrong ashes. And he's buried in a very fancy tomb in a very fancy cemetery. And what are they going to do?
Oh, gosh.
Who cares, you would say, right? They cared a lot. You know, yeah, sorry.
I had a question. So you mentioned that Day of the Dead in Mexico, or celebrated within Mexico, is more materialistic.
Well, the things. Well, what I mean is that the images. You know, when you go to Halloween, you see probably as many ghost things around as you do material skeletons. Mm-hmm. Like around here, ghosts are big on Halloween. Boo. Mm-hmm. My sense of the Mexican altars of the dead are very. They're very material. They're very concrete. You eat real food. their skeletons, their skulls. They're interested in the bodies of the dead as much as in the spirits of the dead, is what I was suggesting. You think that's not right?
No, well, when you mentioned it, I got the assumption that you thought it was just material and it wasn't about, like, spirits coming and visiting and, like, being with
them. Yeah, look, I think you are with the dead. I guess my question, my sense is being with the dead. And you, as I say, I'm a total fraud speaking about the Mexican Day of the Dead, so you'll know much more than I do. But my sense was that the emblems of this are quite material, the dancing skeletons, and you're happy to, with the dead who are there in some version of spirit. But its representations is very material rather than ethereal.
So how did you do the research within Day of the Dead?
How can I do
it? Like, how did, what was your research method?
Well, I I've read my friend Claudio Lomnitz's book, which is a lot on the Day of the Dead, but I didn't do ethnographic research on the Day of the Dead. I mean, I've just read, Family Brand is here, wrote a book on the dead. I've read about it, but this is not, you know, what I've done research on. I just connected it to the European, to the, I mean, look, it's a Catholic country, and so it gets the Day of the Dead in its current version from All Souls and All Saints. But it also gets it from these much older traditions, as does everyone else, is what I want to suggest. You see what I mean? So it's the so that's what I'm trying. What I'm trying to suggest is that there's there are always two histories going on. There's a syncretic tradition, and then there's one that has some justification in theology, and these are kind of merged. These are put together. And the Mexican dead that I think is also has recent histories in Mexican representation of the dead, and you know the most famous Mexican graphic artist like Posada. You know, I mean, there's a whole world of producing the Mexican Day of the Dead, which we could. You know, people have written wonderful books about. So I have no method on this. But I do know, I have read enough to know that the actual exuberance of the current celebrations are pretty recent. And that diaspora communities are very important in bringing them back to Mexico. And regions of Mexico, which never had them before, start getting them in my lifetime. And that's been pretty well studied, you know, but where it is and which parts it's important.
Tom, maybe we could take one more.
Yeah, question. Sure. Yeah, I'm sorry.
Right. Have a few more.
Well, I'm happy that whatever, you know. Yeah,
or
sorry.
We take two more.
Okay.
just like a quick comment. I think that it's really interesting how, like, we see this perception, like, of ghosts being as, like, you know, like you mentioned, like, kind of scary and, like, unfriendly, and why not? And I also think that, like, in the Mexican culture, it's really interesting how it's very connected to memory. So you actually like have these altars because you have the belief that maybe a ghost will appear, but it's not like with that frightening feeling. It's more like with that happiness that it brings to your home. Because I think that like in the Mexican culture, it's more like celebrating the death and like celebrating actually that the fact that you're still alive. And it's kind of like fooling
right. The
death. It's like, okay, yeah. And it's true, like we also are changing and modifying how we celebrate it and like different rituals that we do. And what is interesting for me right now in contemporary Mexico is like how we're shifting like Day of the Dead, like talking about social movements. You know, right now with the state of Mexico, like we have a lot of deaths. So how do you also incorporate that like with the social aspect
right.
to it.
Well, especially with death, with the level of violent death in Mexico and right now, how that gets incorporated. No, but memory is what all this is about, right? In other words, I mean, everywhere. Now, you're right, the Mexican version is probably more exuberant than the Northern European version of this, though not that all Jewish versions of the dead. In other words, whether you do this act cheery or not cheery, or comfort or not cheery, is quite specific, and you're absolutely right about the Mexican case, as far as I can tell. Well, you're not the only people who are cheery about the dead. But it's always about memory, and I think what you said at the end is really interesting, because there's there's a way in which a current political situation is kind of incorporated into this holiday, which actually also has its origins in earlier Mexican interest in the dead. You know, a culture which is probably more than, I mean, the thesis of Claudio Lomnitz's book is that Mexico is the only nation in the world which takes as its kind of totem a death symbol. I mean, that's a kind of remarkable story in itself. So what's interesting to me and what's important It was everything we do with the dead. It's both real, it's both invented now, but it's never invented out of nothing. You know, it's invented out of a series of histories. And almost all of us have this need for memory and to connect ourselves to other human communities. Whatever, right? And we all do it in different ways. So that's, right? So I don't know whether the Mexican versions of the day, they were quite as cheerful in the late 19th century. Man, someone must know this. I just don't know it. And I'd be fascinated to know how the modern story of these disappearances and these murders and so forth are inscribed in this. It's really important and interesting.
Yeah. It's really interesting for me because I have visited a lot of altars throughout the Bay Area, and it's just like such a heavy political aspect implemented into them that it's like also like this wake up of consciousness, like using a holiday like to tell our people, hey, you know, something's going on.
No, it'd be interesting to know when that and how that happens. I mean, I'm fascinated.
Yeah.
I had a question, I think, related to that. If in the literature that you've reviewed, what did you find, since it's so important to do the right burial and to visit a burial site, what happens to relatives of the Holocaust or the 43 students in Mexico, or the genocide in Guatemala? What happens to the living if there is no place?
Well, as you know, it's a really important and interesting question. As you know, what happens is we try to recuperate history. I mean, I don't know if you've that famous Woody Guthrie songs about the unnamed Mexican, the immigrants.
Deportees.
Yeah. Well, someone has not named those deportees.
Right. Right. Yeah.
Right. But someone went through and named, and it's an act of historical recuperation. And if you go to Père Lachaise now, all around the great cemetery in Paris, all around the eastern boundaries of Père Lachaise are monuments where people have taken ashes from concentration camps and put them up in places which you can visit as places where there they are. And as you know, in Guatemala, people all over the world, people are trying to find who's in these tombs and naming them and giving them a place. And that's the Jewish version of this, Yad Vashem in Jerusalem. Yad Vashem means a name and a place. And it means that God promised this was case a eunuch who would have no children. I mean, the traditional thing is you live on through your children, and God promised that even those who have no children will have a name and a place, the Yad Vashem. And that's so this is the Jewish version of it, but as you know from your work, everyone wants to have a name and a place. Mm-hmm. And all sorts of people, obviously in Argentina is a famous example, in Guatemala is a famous example, I mean, all over. We try to, they do it in South Africa. I mean, in other words, everywhere someone is murdered and displaced, people try to find a place. And insofar as you can recuperate a horrible history, giving people a name is a form of recuperation that seems to be pretty general as a political act. And we see it in the 9/11. I mean, there's example after example of people recuperating the dead. It's a major form of, and it's a very interesting, because the Mexican, very interesting project that I learned about in a meeting. What's the Mexican Spanish word for hummingbird? Sorry,
colibri.
Right. There's a colibri project, and for some reason, the hummingbird in this person's mind is associated with these returning. So this person has a large project now to try to identify and inform the relatives and probably bury all these thousands of people who've died in the Mexican desert crossing the borders. And it's very difficult because Texas, and Arizona, doesn't have a medical examiner system. So even people who die, no one looked at Scalia's body. He could have been poisoned for all we know because there's no medical examiner where he died. But these bodies are just left there. And so she tries to organize getting DNA samples, getting the Mexican consul to help possibly find which regions of Mexico in particular state could be from, to look for people who have missed their relatives. And so this whole project is an effort to rename, to find a name for these bodies which are nameless in the desert. And it's a major forensic effort. She's a young forensic anthropologist in Arizona who is doing this with her life. So there are so many of these examples of people trying to reincorporate the dead who've been cast out of humanity back into the the world of our world, back in our world.
Mm-hmm. Well, okay. With that, I really want to thank Tom Laqueur for being with us.